Bless you. My name is Brother Briggs. I know most of you, and most of you know me already, but for those watching online, I come from Ohio. I come from Southwest Ohio. By the grace of God, I'll just know this real quick. I used to live in Northeast Ohio, actually, and recently I started going to...
It's good, brother.
Can you guys hear me well?
Yeah, you don't have to touch it. Yeah, it's good.
Recently, I started going to Antioch Fellowship of the Elect, which is Dayton, Ohio, with Pastor Jacob, Brother John, Brother Corey, Sister Christina, and their children. And about a year ago, I became a member there by the grace of God. And recently, you know, after much praying about it and asking God to lead me, you know, I was, Brother John told me that he would be willing to help me out by giving me a place at his house you know, get settled there and move closer. Because I was driving 3.5 hours for to go to church on Sunday, and then I was driving on Wednesdays for Bible studies. And so, yeah, about 2 months ago, God led me to find a job there in Dayton, Ohio. And I eventually God led me to move, and that's where I've been in Dayton, Ohio. And so, anyway, I just wanted to throw that out for you, people online that don't know who I am. I come from Ohio, and it's great to be here once again at Atlanta's Open 2024, 20-year anniversary. Praise God.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, praise God. I started coming to these meetings back in 2021. My first SOPA was in Virginia Beach, and I just wanted to thank all the work that is put on these conferences. It's really been a blessing in my life. Brother Dick, Brother JK, Brother John, all the leadership. I'm just thankful, and God bless you guys. Well, the topic here, it's the armor of God. Putting on the whole armor of God. So, of course, I'm going to go. If you're willing, please go with me to Ephesians 6. It's where we've been spending most of our time there. Ephesians chapter 6. And I'd like to start on verse 10. Say, go ahead and say amen when you're there.
Amen out there.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Amen. So we see in verse 10 here, Paul speaking to the church, to the saints in Ephesus. It says, to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So he's giving them, it's not a suggestion, he's not telling them, hey, try to be strong in the Lord. He's not suggesting, if you can, be strong in the Lord. No, he's telling them, be
Amen.
Strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And so you wonder, well, okay, Paul, you're telling us to do this, but how do we do it? Well, verse 11 says, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And so we see here that in order for us to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, we need to put on the whole armor of God. I love what the brothers have been preaching about. It's not, he's not telling them to put some armor of God on. You know, he's not telling them to do that. He's telling them the whole armor of God. Why? So the purpose of you doing that is that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And so I went ahead and looked up the word wild on the Webster's 1828 dictionary. This is what it says. It says a trick or a stratagem practiced for ensnaring or deception, a sly, insidious artifice. And the verb for wile is to deceive,
right,
to beguile. And so, you know, we know why Paul is telling us to be strong, to put on the whole armor, because we need to be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, the deception of the devil.
Amen.
You know, if we go to John chapter 4, verse 44, and this is from the King James Version. This is Jesus speaking. The context there is he's talking to the Pharisees. He's talking to the Jews that were not putting up with Jesus, saying that he was from God. He goes on to say in verse 44, John 8:44, ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. So right here we get a really important revelation from Jesus.
Just put that thing on your head, bro.
Yeah.
Flip it the other way. Turn it. Keep turning.
There you go.
All right, now put it back on your ears. Right over the top. There you go.
Oh, okay.
Now you're beautiful. It works now.
Yeah, you keep it kind of far from your mouth. It doesn't have to be real close.
Now do your chin.
Yeah, don't
adjust the side.
Under my chin?
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
Can you guys hear me?
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
So, John chapter 8, verse 44, we get a revelation from Jesus. He's telling us, he's warning us that the devil's a liar.
And
he's a father of lies.
A liar.
You know, and we can go a little bit back, not a little bit, the beginning of the Bible, Genesis, what do we see from the beginning?
Yes.
If you go to Genesis chapter 3, starting on verse 1, it says, now the serpent was more subtle than any of the beasts of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God does know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil.
That's right.
So right off the bat, right from the beginning, we see the devil's schemes. We see the deception of the devil. We see what kind of guy the devil is. The devil's not your friend. You know, we go out to preach on the streets, and a lot of times we hear from people, hell Satan, hell Satan. You know, they of the devil as he's not real or he's our friend, whatever. No, the devil, the Bible says that the devil is here to kill, to steal, and destroy.
Wow.
And so it's very important that we have the whole armor of God, that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. So going back to Ephesians chapter 6. Verse 14, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. So the first part of the armor that Paul talks about, it's the belt of truth. And, you know, I did a little bit of a research about, you know, because when you see that verse, you start to think, well, what does it mean to have your loins girt about? What is he trying to communicate to us? Well, I was doing a little bit of research, and you know, back in the day, most Jewish men wore an inner garment called a tunic. The tunic was often held in at the waist by a belt. So this is a piece of garment that most Jewish men used to wear that would go all the way, almost all the way to your feet. And because it was long, it wouldn't allow you to do heavy labor. It wouldn't allow you it wouldn't allow you to go, you wouldn't be in a good situation if you went like that in battle, to go to battle. And so what they have to do is gird up their loins. What they have to do is tuck up that tunic up into the belt that held it, so that they would be ready to do heavy labor and go into the battle. And so if we go back to that verse, Paul speaking, that says, having your loins girt about with truth. So if you don't have your loins girt about with truth, you're not gonna be able to do heavy labor for the Lord.
True.
If you don't have your loins girt about with truth, you're not gonna be ready to fight the good fight of the faith. Amen. So it's very important that we have the truth. What's the truth? Well, Jesus is the truth.
Amen.
And Jesus also said, thy word is truth. So the word of God is the truth. And it's very important that we have the right doctrine. Who was it? I forget, but Brother David, might have been Brother David, that said, if you have... the belt of truth, speaking about the belt of truth, we are not to have the belt loose.
Right.
Otherwise, you know, it's not going to help you. So if you have loose doctrine, if you have bad doctrine, you know, we're all sinners. We're all humans, brother. Wow. We're all going to sin. We all sin every day.
Yeah.
But you still go out and preach to people. Yes. Your sword is going to be dull. You're not going to be able to be effective for the Lord.
Yeah.
So you're going to have your loins girt about with the truth. And it goes on to say, having on the breastplate of righteousness. You know, Brother John was speaking about it, that it's a gift of God. And also it's purity from the heart. It's obeying God's commandment. It's keeping yourself in the love of God. Well, we know by the word that if you love God, you will keep his commandments, right? So if you're not loving God, if you're not keeping God's commandments, you don't have a breastplate of righteousness. You're vulnerable. You're not fit for the battle.
That's right.
So verse 15. And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You know, as Christians, we've been saved for a purpose. We've been saved for a mission. We were not saved to stay inside the four walls of the church. We were not saved to stay on the pew and do nothing for the Lord. Don't you have a testimony? What has God saved you from? What's the Great Commission? Jesus said, go into all the world and preach.
Amen.
You're called to go out into the world and preach.
Amen.
The gospel. So you gotta have, if you don't have a testimony, if you're, you haven't been saved, Jesus came to save us from our sin.
Amen. Yes.
And so verse 16, above all, taking the shield of faith.
Amen.
Wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. You know, I love this type of conferences because you get to see, we get to see each other's viewpoints on certain verses.
Amen.
And, you know, of course, faith. We are saved by faith. We are saved by grace through faith. And, you know, when I read this scripture, it makes me think of what Jesus had to go through. Jesus had to endure temptation just as we do have to endure temptation. And so we gotta take the shield of faith. Where's our faith placed on? Well, our faith is placed on the Word of God, the Bible, the B-I-B-L-E. When Jesus was tempted, if we go to Matthew chapter 4, we'll look at what Jesus did to be victorious when temptation was coming his way.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written,
yes,
man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
Amen.
Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, and it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God.
Amen.
Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and he showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then saith Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve.
Amen.
Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him.
Amen.
What a powerful scripture. You know, there was, you know, of course, once you become a saint, you know, you're going to be willing to obey God, love God, keep His commandments, and you're going to have the whole armor of God. But, Jesus, He's our example as Christians. You know, if there was ever a man who had it right from the beginning was Jesus Christ. He showed us how to be victorious, how to win every time.
Amen.
How to win the victory every time.
Amen.
And so what a great scripture. So Jesus knew the Word. He knew His Bible. We must strive, including me. We all must strive to know our Bible, to know the Word of God. It's the only way that we'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, every temptation, every doubt, every Brother Dick was talking about the fiery darts as a ballistic missile, precise ballistic missile. Like the devil will try. He knows. He knew where to try to get Jesus to fall down. He said, "If you fall down and worship me, I'll give you all these things." So he tried to test him with fame, get him puffed up, and so the devil knows. He knows. He has schemes. He has ways. So it's very critical that we know our Bible.
Amen. Yes.
Verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
Amen.
Again, the helmet. Brother John was also saying that the breastplate of righteousness, it protects your heart and your most vital organs. The helmet protects the head. The helmet protects the mind. How do we keep our mind protected by taking on the helmet of salvation? We have assurance of salvation.
Amen.
If you're living holy, if you're walking uprightly before the Lord, you have assurance of salvation. You gotta know that there's no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
That's right.
So if you're walking in the Spirit, you're not under condemnation. If you are walking in the flesh, however, in the works of the flesh, living in sin, you are going to be under condemnation. And so the helmet of salvation, we have assurance. If you're living holy, if you're living in sin, be sure that you're going to be condemned. So you need to repent of your sins and cry out to God. And lastly, to end here, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
Amen.
So then again, the Word of God is double two-edged sword. So it's a weapon.
Yep.
It's a weapon of warfare. It's not a kitchen knife. It's a weapon of warfare that you use to attack with, but you also use to defend yourself with.
Yeah.
That's the Word of God.
Amen.
And I'll just close with this verse here, lastly. Let's see here. So go ahead and turn to Ephesians chapter 3, please. If you would, please. Ephesians chapter 3. Starting on verse 14. Now, this is Paul again. This is Paul speaking to the church in Ephesus, to the saints in Ephesus. For this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit. hear a very important point. This is Paul speaking, telling other Christians, praying for other Christians, telling them that that God would grant them according to the riches of His glory to be strengthened with might by His Spirit in the inner man. And so, you know, we read about Jesus going through the temptation. Well, if you read a little bit earlier than that, if you go a little bit before that scripture, what happened before Jesus went into the Spirit, led Jesus into temptation? He was baptized with the Holy Spirit of God. Well, we see in the book of Acts, Peter, Jesus told Peter that he was going to deny him three times, and he did. When it was all boiling down and things were getting hard, Jesus was about to get crucified, and in the heat of the moment, Peter denied Jesus three times. But what do we see in the book of Acts? We see the man of God waiting for the promise of receiving the Holy Spirit. And we see after that happened that they went out in boldness by the Spirit of God. They went out and preached with boldness,
yes.
and with power the Word of God. And so, we are strengthened by the Holy Spirit of God. Our strength comes from God, the Spirit of God. And so that's what God gave to me today. And God bless you, saints. It's good to be here. God bless you.